sports. Picturesque views, postcard scenes, images of the Old West. That's Phoenix, Arizona. Her endless blue skies are an amazing sight, but the biggest attraction in the desert this week, the wildlife. High speed, close quarters, and wild action. Busch Series Wildlife.
All clear.
Way, but the cars have fired the engines and they're out helping to drive the racetrack as we get set for the Outback Steakhouse 200. Hi everybody, I'm Ralph Shaheen, sitting alongside NASCAR driving legend Buddy Baker and crew chief Larry McReynolds from the NASCAR Winston Cup division, and we're getting set to bring you the Outback Steakhouse 200. A little bit different open to the show here today because we're trying to hustle things up so NASCAR can quickly get to the green flag. Here's a look at the starting lineup. Jason Leffler and Jeff Green, the newly crowned champ, will be in row one. Jeff Burton and Ron Hornaday in row number two. Jimmy Johnson and David Green in row three. Grubb and McLaughlin in row number four. And we're about two laps away from the green flag. Skinner and Park in five. And Jay Sauter has been awful quick alongside of his brother Tim in row six. Keller and Kyle Petty in row seven. Randy LaJoie and Matt Kenseth in row eight. Michael Waltrip and Kenny Wallace out of the Winston Cup division make up row number nine. McMurray and Elliott Sadler will be in row number 10. Looking back through the rest of the field, Buddy Baker, what do you think we're going to have with the track conditions here today?
Well, one thing we do have is overcast, and the sun peeks out every once in a while. That changes the racing surface, and as Larry McReynolds will tell you, that gives the crew chief a little more to worry about. Not that they don't already have enough.
Well, Buddy, this track is something to worry about, even if the weather's consistent. Both ends are totally different. It's almost like a one-mile D-shaped road course. But, you know, over the course of the season, we've seen cars running different grooves, but you got to run the bottom at Phoenix to win the race.
You know, Mike Dillon has already crashed under the caution here. They're working on the front of his car on pit road right now. He's got in the back of somebody just getting ready for the green flag. You can see him working on the car right now. A lot of damage to the nose.
That's the number 21 machine. We do have two pit reporters with us, of course, on our TNN broadcast, Glenn Jarrett and Steve Burns. And let's check in with Steve on the Dillon story.
Yeah, on the warm-up lap, we're just underwent. Dillon ran into the back of the 63 car. That's how he got all the damage on the number 21 car just warming up. He flat ran into the back of the 63 car of Mark Green.
Buddy, racing tires in the NASCAR Busch Series, of course, have no tread to them. Most of us have never driven on tires like that. As I look out the window here today, thinking about driving my street car, this isn't even the big shower. How different is it for the drivers of these cars with these kinds of tires?
Well, what they're doing right now is going back and forth, getting the surface of the racing tire cleaned up and everything, and you look down at the gauges, and probably what happened there is maybe he just backed off a little bit, and Mike Dillon didn't see that he had backed off and run right into him. It's so easy to do, but right now the racetrack looks like it's in pretty good shape.
Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, they're working on getting the racetrack in better shape, but one of the things that the drivers don't like, particularly those on the outside line, Jeff Green is starting second. He's radioing in. The jet drivers are up the top of the racetrack trying to help drive the racetrack, but they're blowing a lot of grit and debris from the Winston Cup happy hour right back down in the outside groove. So in their efforts to make it a little better for those guys on the outside line, things are actually getting a little worse. So they're working on those tires right now. Incidentally, the tire rule for today is two sets per position under caution, so plus the set that they are starting the race on. So already a little griping and grumbling from the guy saying, hey, they're making this place dirty.
The 61 car of Tim Sauter is making his way down pit road as well. And let's show you the in-car cameras that we'll have here today.
behind in his number 66, giving us this view. Joe Nemechek has this cellular one onboard camera view for us. Jeff Purvis bringing us supporter cable camera. Two-time champ of the Busch Series, Randy LaJoy. Jason Keller is starting 13th today. He's going to carry the Circuit City onboard camera. Jason, of course, trying to lay claim to number two in the point standings. And the Altel camera will be on board with the car starting fifth today. Jimmy Johnson. Jeff Burton from the Winston Cup Series is starting third, and he's got this view. And if you got a newly crowned champ, you got to put a camera with him. There he is, the 2000 season Busch Grand National Series champion, carrying the Circuit City onboard camera, Jeff Green. Well, here we go. Glad to have you with us. TNN's final live coverage of the NASCAR Busch Grand National Series. Glad to have had you with us all these years. Happy to close it out with a great one from Phoenix. Here we go. This racetrack has had great success here, not only in Southwest Tour, but also in the Craftsman Truck Series.
Well, also, we got to remember, it was 1 year ago in this Busch race that I think people knew that Ron Hornaday was serious about being a competitor on the Busch Series, led this race for quite a while.
Hornaday is originally from California, but spent so much time racing here on this mile in Phoenix, he feels that this is his home racetrack.
Well, and he had a situation last year as a teammate with Earnhardt Jr. There were several times I was sure that maybe he had to back off a little bit and let Earnhardt Jr. lead a lap and get the points. And when he did drop back, he never could regain the lead.
Mike McLaughlin in the 48, battling it out with the 34 of David Green. Give the position to McLaughlin. All of us in the world of motorsports suffered a tremendous loss this past weekend with the passing of our TNN colleague, Steve Evans. Steve was a broadcast legend, a true pioneer. He has been a part of the TNN family since the beginning of the network. It has been a privilege for all of us at TNN to call Steve a colleague, a mentor, and a friend. Our prayers are with his family. Steakhouse 200, and we've had a great battle up front. When we left you, it was Ron Hornaday who was up front. Jason Leffler has moved back into the lead, and he's taking Jeff Burton right along with him. Let's show you how Leffler got back up into the lead in the box on the lower right, buddy.
Right on the bottom of the racetrack, he just powers by Hornaday as they start off the corner. You can see the car is very equally matched down the straightaway. As they go in the flat part of the racetrack up into turn three, though, you'll notice he gets a good run down into turn three. Now he just gets in the throttle early and brings Jeff Burton right along with him as they both go by.
Of course, Jason Leffler, Larry, is another driver who has a tremendous amount of experience at this racetrack, although in much different types of cars, coming out of the USAC series, running midgets and Silver Crown cars here with the world-famous Copper World Classic.
But there's no question, if you watch this year come about, you have watched him mature just quite a bit and just gets better with every race. And they tell me that Jay Sauter is pulled behind the wall. I think Glenn Jarrett's with him.
Jason Leffler continuing to lead this one. We're having a little trouble getting to Glenn, but we'll get to him here in just a second. Well, a let's try to get back in touch with Glenn Jarrett. Glenn, I spoke to Kerry Agajanian this morning, and they said they expected great things out of that 43. What happened?
Well, Ralph, they had a very fast car. It was like one of the 10 top quick cars in happy hour yesterday afternoon. Had high hopes. He dropped a valve. He came in. There was a lot of smoke coming out the exhaust pipes. You see him pushing him behind the wall right now. Tough break for Jay and Kerry and all the guys on that team. They've had kind of a tough season. They were hoping to top it off with it to make things a little better here at Phoenix. It just wasn't to be. Drop valve for Jay Sauter.
Curb Motorsports entry. Kerry Agajanian and Mike Curb come to get Jay Sauter out to the racetrack, and their day going to come to a quick end, unfortunately. Now, here's the great battle that you're looking at for 12th, 13th, 14th, and so on.
Riding with Randy LaJoy is that you look back at Tim Fedewa in the 36 car, the black and yellow car there. LaJoy, these guys are going at it.
I'm sorry, buddy. LaJoy is actually in the 13th position. That would make Fedewa, the car you're looking at, in 14th. And that's Kenseth in front of LaJoy, which we're looking at the backside of.
And talking about Matt Kenseth, the Visine car there yesterday in the final practice, the dry shed.
Oh, look at that. Did you see the contact made there?
That's coming off turn two right there, buddy.
What's happening right now is Jeff Burton's looking on either side, trying to get track position. He's got a little bit faster car than Leffler, but Leffler's doing a great job of holding him off.
And what we talked about in the opening, Jason Leffler is running this racetrack where you're supposed to run it, right around the bottom, because it's so hard to pass on the outside.
How far down do you have to have the car here, Larry?
Well, we saw a shot while ago of Jason Leffler's valence. You get the car very, very soft, just enough to hold it up off the racetrack, and you start the air pressure. Here you see him moving in on turn three. Leffler carries it on down in there pretty deep, buddy. But you run the car just soft enough to keep it off the racetrack, and you start the air pressure very, very low, and that sometimes will help the car on a long run especially.
Just watching Hornaday, he moved right in on the back bumper, and I think right now Jeff Burton just biding his time. He has a fast race car, but he got up there and started racing. That just brought all the cars back up there. The first five now running nose to tail.
There is a good look at the nose of the cars as they go through three and four, as you're talking about, Larry. You can see how low they've got that nose, almost scraping on the ground.
Well, that's the thing, and you see that the valence will actually be pretty far up off the ground. There you see he's going off into turn one. It's just, again, they're running to where it's sealing the car to the asphalt, and it helps their aerodynamics as well.
And you can see one other thing. They're actually dropping below the yellow line, getting into turn one, and what they're doing is hitting the flat part of the racetrack and trying to get the car to turn better as they start into the corner.
Now coming into today, Jason Leffler in his Busch Series career only led four laps prior today. So far, he's led all but four.
We'd like to thank TNN for all their involvement in racing and what they've done for us and NASCAR, ASA. You know, I came from the ASA ranks, so I think TNN helped build the ASA circuit, which is a good stepping stone for Busch Grand National wins the Cup. But, you know, canned beer, country music, racing, we're all parallel, you know, and it's just what the sign says. Thank you, TNN.
Big thank you from the spotters as well, the Schneider sponsor, spotters up on the roof above us, watching Dick Trickle go around in his number five machine, which is currently running 33rd, and we really appreciate that.
Tell you what, that's quite a tribute from Dick Trickle, probably the winningest race car driver anywhere. He has over 2,000 wins.
Being a 200 lap affair here, and the weather out in the surrounding area, Steve Burns, what the teams do with pit strategy today is going to be a key factor in the outcome of this one.
Hey, you're exactly right, Ralph. I talked to Ricky Byers, Elton Sawyer's crew chief, and he said they thought they had the car in good shape, but they're kind of concerned about what to do. Now, these cars can run about 105 laps. Anything over 100 laps, they're going to start thinking about when to get gas if we stay green. And in last year's race here, we only had one caution. So a lot of crew chiefs scratching their heads before this race started.
You know, I think the strategy is, I won't say it's simple. There's no racing strategy simple, but I think when you've got a 200-lap race, Goodyear has brought a tire that lasts pretty good here and don't give up that bad, and you can run over 100 laps on fuel somewhere in that 100-lap to 105-lap window. That's when you come in and get four more tires and fuel. And Phoenix, even in Winston Cup, is known for long green runs, so you got to figure that into the equation.
Steve Park makes a pass in number 31 on Mike Skinner to take over six.
Yeah, and he did it pretty well. He just went down in turn three and just powered by on the bottom side. Mike Skinner had been moving up, but Steve Park right at the moment is just flying around this racetrack.
As you take a look at the box in the upper left, our scoring system, you'll notice every now and then you'll see the numbers on the right side right there, like on Matt Kenseth, that are lit up in green. That means that that driver, such as Jeff Purvis, is actually turning a lap quicker than the race leader, who at this point in the game is Jason Leffler. Here comes Todd Bodine to the inside of Casey Atwood. Those two fighting for 25th position right now. Elton Sawyer in the mix with them.
Sawyer had a great run last weekend in Memphis, ended up second place with the 98 car. Very good on flat tracks where you have to have a good tire management program. You can see he worked very well around the bottom part of the racetrack.
Here's the position of Bodine. Buddy, earlier today you and I were downstairs visiting with Todd Bodine, and he's come up along with Bill Simpson, a brand new safety device that really looks like it helped revolutionize things.
I think so, and it's a connection between the helmet and the actual racing suit that they're wearing, and it clips on to keep the head from moving forward at a great rate if you hit something. So they're working on things that will save some of these drivers if they have the high impact in the concrete walls.
Well, I think that's the real problem that we got to keep working on. You know, we've done things with the back of the seat to keep the driver's head in place from the back. We've got head supports on the left and right. The real problem now is the driver's head and body trying to go forward on sudden impact. If we can cure that, I think we can help a lot of these injuries.
Todd Bodine working with one of the greatest innovators in all of racing when it comes to safety, Bill Simpson, to make that come together. Let's check in with Glenn Jarrett with more on Elton Sawyer.
Well, I talked to Elton right before the race, guys, and he was pretty high about his chances. He knew that he started pretty deep in the field, and he admitted that they were terrible when they got here. He said they just didn't have the right setup under the car. This is the same tire that the teams used last week in Memphis, Tennessee. So you would think that, you know, they got the car hooked up pretty well there, and they thought so too, but it didn't work out that way. They changed literally everything under that race car, finally got it to where Elton liked it. His biggest concern was having to work through all this traffic because he started so deeply in the field. But once again, for about the third or fourth week in a row, he has got a really fast race car.
And he's going to have a birthday tomorrow, Glenn. He's going to turn 41 years old. Know a little about the 40s there, Larry?
I discovered it about 2 years ago.
Did you really?
Shut up.
I don't know.
Back to the lead. Jason Leffler still out front. The thing that really annoys me about Leffler, he doesn't even know anything about the 30s. He knows a lot about the lead at the Outback Steakhouse 200, though. With millions of brand name auto parts and accessories to choose from, it's easy to prove you're a wrenchhead. Are you a wrenchhead? Wrenchhead.com, parts online all the time. Welcome back to the Outback Steakhouse 200. Coming your way live, TNN's last Busch Series telecast. We're in Phoenix, Arizona, with Jason Leffler in the 18 leading Jeff Burton's number 9.
And they're getting into some pretty good lap traffic right now. Mike Dillon, you can see the front of that car, actually wrecked before the green flag came out, ran in the back of the car as they were warming up here. And the car is not aerodynamic, but you can see it's not that far off the pace. He's able to keep up with the leaders right now as they start to get by him. Have to lean on him a little, I guess.
You know, no Pontiac is one from the pole in the Busch Series for quite a while.
Boy, that has been a while. 9 years ago, Chuck down there at Myrtle Beach. They've won races and they've set on poles. They just hadn't done it the same weekend in a while.
In fact, Pontiac's last win in the Busch Series came back in May of 98 at Loudoun, New Hampshire with Buckshot Jones. And Buddy, Loudoun, New Hampshire, a flat 1 mile, just like this one.
Well, the Pontiac, a lot of people tell me that the Pontiac has great downforce, and they've made a couple rule changes to equalize the cars, but they started out with the Pontiac that wasn't that good, and then they made some changes, and all of a sudden the Pontiac was the car to beat, and they've had some rule changes to equalize the cars, and you can see right now we have a Pontiac, a Ford, and a Chevrolet in the first three spots, so they did it right.
You know, when you go racing and you have a problem on the warm-up lap, Steve Burns, you know it's going to be a long day.
Around Mike Dillon's crew has been hard at work down here. They're actually doing some metal fabricating. This is a piece. You see the arrow this side up. They're going to put that on, tape up some of the other damage, and it looks like they've made another valance to put along the nose piece to help that car handle aerodynamically.
Larry, how much stuff do you have your guys get ready to basically rebuild a car in the pits?
Well, you've got to have a nose ready. We even got the front part of the fenders. Now, we go back to Memphis last week, that little old 5/8-mile racetrack. You're not that worried about aerodynamics. These cars qualified at an average of 130 miles an hour. We see they're racing in the mid-120s, so they're carrying probably 140, 145 miles an hour in these straightaways. Aerodynamics is very important. You got to keep the front end sealed up as much as you can. You got to keep the front end intact. He talked about the front valance. That's the piece at the bottom of the nose. You want to keep that just as low as possible.
The number two car of Kevin Harvick is a car that a lot of us expected a lot out of here today, but Glenn, he's dropping like a rock.
Well, Ralph, there's a reason for that. On the very start of the race, he was trying to get by the 25 car, and he got into the wall, and he hit it hard enough that it has knocked the toe out on the car. It has knocked the steering wheel off center, so when you do that, you've hit pretty hard. The car's got a pretty good push to it right now. They're going to have to get him in here at the first pit stop, see if they can make some adjustments on it. But he's fighting a pretty ill-handled race car right now.
That was Mike Wallace that just passed him. And let's show you, buddy, what happened to him in that number two, Kevin Harvick.
Hey, he's down in the corner right here. Boy, he gets into it pretty good right there. Almost spun out. That's Dick Trickle not giving him a lot of room also in the five car. A little contact there also.
And Ricky Craven in the 19.
And what probably has happened here, here we see the battle for the lead. Jeff Burton going down the backstretch, going into turn three.
It's inside of Leffler, and Burton will take the lead for the first time here today.
And what Leffler will try to do is come back on the inside.
Leans right up on him, buddy, but can't get the job done.
Well, what happened there, Leffler actually got on the pit road entrance there, and a flat part of the racetrack and slid back out. So he had to back off or crash.
That's not one of those spots where you say eight tires break better than four.
No, the apron is not where to race. I mean, you put the left side over there and help it turn just a little bit. It kicks the back out. But if you don't want to go down on the flat part, and I'm talking about this part up, well, I almost got to show you. This part of the racetrack right in here, that's not very good to get down there.
Looking at your Napa field standing update in the upper left of your screen. Why do you need genuine Napa replacement parts? Because some things can't be replaced.
Boy, you can see them when they come off turn two there. You can see how close they come to that outside wall. And every once in a while, a driver will get a little careless and actually push out and hit that wall as they come off. And when they do a lot of damage to the car.
Well, it's almost like you run out of racetrack over there, and that's where the car will really start pushing, and the front end won't turn. And the only way you can get it to turn is back off the throttle and slow the car down.
Jeff Burton in the NorthernLight.com. Number nine is the leader, the Outback Steakhouse 200. Stay with him. And got service and is back out. Here's a look from on board with Joe Nemechek heading to turn one.
Down into turn one, down the long straightaway. Now he turns in, everything's okay. Watch right here.
Wow. That definitely has a look that the right front tire just went down.
Yeah, because he already made the turn and the car was sticking well, and all of a sudden it just veered off to the right.
Well, more on the Joe Nemechek story as he visits pit road again. Here's Steve Burns.
And Ralph, the hood goes up on Joe Nemechek's Chevrolet. They're looking at the right front corner. Crew chief Brian Patty reaching inside. Looks like trying to see if there's any loose suspension or chassis parts. The hood's still up on Joe Nemechek's number 87. They're going to make a wedge adjustment and try and get him back out. Again, they're trying to assess the damage. And now he shuts the motor off.
Larry, as a crew chief, we see this all the time after an accident. A car will come down, they'll make a quick fix, get them back out, bring them back in, sometimes two or three times. What's your order on your checklist? What do you want to do the first time, and how do you decide what things you do first and second?
Well, the first thing you got to do, and a good thing you can do, is communicate with a spotter, because he's got a good view and he can kind of assess the damage. First thing you got to do is get any tires that's down or flat, that get those changed, get him back on four tires rolling. And I think the case with Joe Nemechek, and we also saw the two car of Kevin Harvick, the toe out was knocked out because it hit the wall. You're adjusting the tie rods, you're getting the toe out set. Steve Burns, I think, is with Joe Nemechek's crew chief right now.
Yeah, and that's Brian Patty, Larry. Brian, what put you up? Looks like you can go ahead back to the garage. What happened?
When we had that flat tire and we hit the fence, it knocked the fuel pump off the motor. Seen plenty of fires, and we don't need to burn this car down. We're not here for points, so it's just real unfortunate. We just had a bad weekend all weekend and thought we had a pretty good race car. And I saw it coming down the front stretch. It didn't look right, and he got off and was on the brakes a whole lot earlier than normal, and then he hit the fence. So he's pretty smart. Just a bad fortune day for a second one Chevrolet.
Thanks, Brian.
I got to tell you, that fuel pump's a good ways away from the frame itself, and if it goes over far enough to knock it off, they got a lot of problems they don't even realize, like bent ball joints under the front. There's so many things that are bent on that car. Fuel pump's just one of them.
You got to hit pretty good to get to it, don't you?
You got it.
Blaze Alexander on pit road as well. Getting service on the number 81. Working our first caution flag of the day here at the Outback Steakhouse 200. Jeff Burton is still your leader. Ron Hornaday, Jason Leffler, Jeff Green, Jason Keller, the top five. And it's Skinner, Purvis, Grubb, Kenseth, and Kenny Wallace in the top 10.
Well, I'm sure Mike Dillon's had a sigh of relief because he made the improvements of the aerodynamics on the front of the 21 car. Maybe he'll get back up to speed now.
Pace car lights are off. Jeff Burton seems to have really mastered all the things he's learned from working as a teammate with Mark Martin. He was very patient in the first part of this race following Leffler. When he saw the opening, that's when he took.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. I think right at the moment, the Ford car itself is a pretty good car for this type of racetrack. And next year, Jeff Green, Jason Keller are switching to Ford. There hadn't been many of them out there, but they made a pretty good record this year as far as wins.
On board with Jeff Green, you can see the telemetry as we go back to racing.
And he restarted in second gear, grabbed third gear. He's to high gear before he gets to turn one. This is in the middle of turn one and two, about 100 miles an hour. You hear him feathering the throttle right there, and that's because he's got good fresh tires, but the air pressures are down. This is going up the long backstretch, buddy.
See about 7,800 there. And tomorrow in the Winston Cup race, you'll see 9,400 down the straightaway. These are 9-1 compression motors. They don't like a lot of RPM, but they pull really good.
How about this star hot, Robert? You don't hear nothing down there.
That's Harold Hawley talking to him. He's crew chief. Hornaday really would like to leave this facility with a win in this Busch Series event. Buddy, it sounds like Ron Hornaday is going to be moving up to the Winston Cup ranks.
Yeah, and we were told who it was, and I think the choice is perfect. A.J. Foyt is going to make a good team for Ron Hornaday. Hornaday goes wide open, just like old Tex used to do when he was racing. He had two speeds, wide open and stop.
I was going to say, A.J. might have shifted down a little bit, but I don't think he went down too many gears yet. He's still going at it pretty hard. A good driver at a racetrack like this, Leonard?
Well, I think you've got to use that patience, and you know, you've got to, especially, and I think that's what happened a while ago with Jason Leffler and Jeff Burton. When they got to that lap traffic, I think experience maybe kind of took over right there. So, you know, you've got to show patience. You've got to take care of those tires when the pressures are down in the beginning of the run, because you know you may have to run them for a long green flag run.
Well, these guys are not taking care of anything but business. They're rubbing and pushing and gouging and trying to get to the front, and they were three wide down the straightaway, and then just barely got back. There's been a lot of contact going on this after the restart here,
including between the 30 and the 63. The 30, of course, is Remy Sadler, and the 63 is Mark Green. Here comes Kyle Petty in the sprint number 45. Kyle's in 21st position right now. There's Casey Atwood in the 27, getting inside of Michael Waltrip in the Band-Aid number 7.
And that's Bobby Hamilton Jr. just behind him in the 26 there.
Band-Aid, by the way, will be leaving Michael Waltrip at the end. Logan for his sponsor. That's why they have the all-white paint scheme this weekend. There's Jason Keller at the 57. This is a battle for fifth. He's running with Mike Skinner, your driver in the Winston Cup Tour, Larry.
Well, yeah, he made some long runs yesterday with this car in happy hour and was pretty pleased with it. It's a little bit different chassis than he's normally running. It's what we call a low snout or a drop snout where the roll center's down low to help a car turn on a flat racetrack right here. And, again, he's running sixth, and seems like things going pretty good for him.
Larry, we hear a lot about roll center. What does that mean in layman's terms?
Well, I think, you know, the biggest thing is the lower that you can keep the pivot points of the geometry of the front end, which is where the A-frames hook up and everything, it won't maybe necessarily feel that good on a bank racetrack where you're driving against the bank and entering the corner at such a high rate of speed, but where these corners are so flat and the whole secret is turning in the middle, sometimes keeping the roll center just a little bit lower because you're not worried about how getting in the corner, going through the middle of the corner is what you're worried about, it'll work a little better.
That's understanding where the axis and the chassis and all that comes together, knowing the geometry of the car and how that car is going to turn. Okay.
That's the reason we have so many engineers.
That's Jimmy Johnson coming down into the pit area. This is certainly not a scheduled pit stop.
Now, Johnson is on pit road.
Check everything out real good.
They're going to take care of...